And now we'll ask Mr. Pantazopoulos to come and take over. We are going to the next panel of our day. Michalis. So our next panel is on safety and security. Oh, there he is. And by the way, after this, we have a dynamite presentation on insurance, piracy.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your attention. We are pretty much towards the end of a very successful conference today, and thank Nick for the effort in putting together a lot of technical and shipping related people. We are going to spend a few minutes rather entertaining you on ship safety, regulatory compliance, and third-party inspections. And for this, we put more than 100 years of experience on this table. Probably I count the years, each one of, it's a, no, no, I don't put mine in, mine. So, next to me is Panos Zachariadis, Technical Director of Atlantic Bulk Carriers and Bulk Carrier Manager Operating Company. Next, Stavros Meidanis, S&Q Manager of Capital Ship Management, a company with tankers, bulk carriers, and containers. Next, Theofanis Sallis, General Manager Operation of GasLog, LNG vessels. Stylianos Siafakas, Chief Executive Officer of his own company, Dromon Maritime, which he is putting together all the vast experience from product tankers and tanker management before. He will talk to us about this. And last, Dimitris Patrikios, I call him the star, Chief Operating Officer of Springfield Shipping, managers of tankers and bulk carriers. And of course, as you understand, we are all friends on this panel. Allow me to say a few words on what we think to offer you. Regulatory compliance as per IMO basically covers conventions like SOLAS, STCW, MARPOL, and MLC. These are enforced by flag state, the flag state of the vessel, and the RO, the usually classification societies, and audited by port state control of national states. On the other hand, third-party inspections include vetting inspections by oil majors, the TMSA program that you heard earlier, right ship inspections and assessment, as well as the scoring board, P&I club inspections, and they are considered rather commercial-driven inspections. What are the advantages and the shortcomings of the current statu quo of both sides, regulatory and third party? What is the role of the human factor in the regulatory compliance cycle and also in the commercial cycle. Are there any recommendation for an improved safety culture for the benefit of the shipping industry at large? Those are some of the issues we will be discussing here. But as I represent the Liberian Registry, and in fact we are a flag state and a regulator, I would like to spend 1 minute to tell you what we consider good practices to promote safety. So we use mandatory annual safety inspection of our vessels, onboard safety drills on a monthly basis, and safety training sessions on a weekly basis. Frequent guidance to masters. We have the capacity as a flag to do ISM, ISPS, MLC audit and verification if the RO performed the audit on our behalf. On the port state control, we have gone a step further, and in addition to the port state detention analysis and our flag state detention analysis, we offer detention prevention programs, active working with port state controls. We have like 6 months meeting of different MOU, and also a formal appeal process on port state control detention if there is no validity on the deficiency. Casualty investigation and analysis, which is obviously a reactive measure. Plus an RO cooperation and monitoring, and active participation in international organizations like the IMO, STCW, etc. And this is as far as a flag state does. Now, what the shipping companies and how the shipping companies view the regulatory cycle of inspection as well as the commercial, we start with, from my left side, Panos, and please, what is the views?
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Part of the title of this session is safety and regulatory compliance. And I found some areas, at least, that if you comply with the regulation, it may be to detriment in safety. And this points to regulations that are not being well thought out. And they have like secondary effects that nobody thought when the regulation was put into place, or that somebody thought about it, shouted about it, and nobody listened. So one example that comes to mind immediately is EEDI. If you comply with the EEDI regulation for tankers and bulk carriers, that means that probably you have to install a smaller engine into the ships. That will be a very big problem, not now, but in the next two phases of EEDI, where you have a more stricter and stricter EEDI to comply with. See, there is two ways you can comply with EEDI. One is to build a ship with reduced resistance, good hull lines, and the other, the easy way, is to just install a smaller engine on any ship. And that's because of the formula of EEDI. So early on at IMO, Greece pointed that out, and they said, the easy way is to install a smaller engine, and we're going to have problems with this. And they also, through submissions, they gave IMO the way out, how to change the formula, so it's not so easy for shipyards to just install a smaller engine. But obviously, the shipbuilding nations, they wanted to have the easy way, so they can comply with EEDI. So after that, Greece said, okay, now we're going to have problems with underpowered ships. Nobody listened. 2 years after that, the Japanese came to us. They said, you're right, we have problems. Some of you may have seen the problems with the smaller engines, that they have a problem with acceleration in rivers and all that. So the Japanese came to us, and now we're trying to figure out what would be a safe minimum power to make it a regulation at IMO, which will override the EEDI requirement. But it's not easy. It's not easy because what safe power for one ship may not be safe for another. It depends how well designed the ship is. But I don't want to make a long story short, and I don't want to stay on the EDI. Another point where if you comply with the regulation, you may have problems in safety. How many terminals will stop loading a ship, waiting for the ship to deballast at the slow deballast rates that now will be in effect after we put water ballast treatment machines? Because we put water ballast treatment machines in one line usually. We're not going to put in two lines. So we cut the deballasting rate of our ships by half. Well, I'm expecting problems there. I'm expecting the terminals will keep loading the ship, and I'm expecting problems with the longitudinal strength of the ship and perhaps buckling and other issues. I'll stop at that for now. I have some thoughts about third-party inspections, but we'll leave that for later. Thank you.
Yes. Good afternoon. Yes, Michalis, further to your initial comments. I have always in my mind two, I would say, main questions, sometimes I would say two main concerns. First of all, inspections, audits, different regulatory bodies, PINDAI, class. What will be the ultimate aim of such an inspection? What we want to achieve? What the regulatory body wants to achieve? To verify what? The safety of the vessel, seaworthiness of the vessel. So the aim, each time, it's a little bit different. And this is a concern because always different approaches creates a confusion for the vessels, and especially to our people. And the second thought, concern that I always have is what about our people on board? We're talking about safety culture. We're going to have safety culture. We have plenty of initiatives our days. This is what we are going, what we want to do. This is the proper way to do that. You know, as we have to keep in our mind that in our days we start discussing about, especially for the crew, about not anymore about their technical skills, but now we are talking about the soft skills. And this is something that we have to take into consideration if we go a step further as flag, administration, as class or commercial inspectors or whatever it is, which is very, very soon mandatory for all of us. This is my initial thoughts, comments. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. To start by stating the obvious, I think that from operations perspective, both vetting and post-trip control are critical elements of the day-to-day business. In post-trip control, if you fail an inspection, the vessel could be mobilized immediately with unknown consequences. In vetting, in such a very competitive market, definitely there is critical contribution to business development and also to link those two. The results of post-trade control are traceable through the vetting process. So there are certain challenges to day-to-day operations from an operator's point of view. And these challenges are of different type and nature and involve different stakeholders as well. For example, to state from our organizations first, some of the people inside the organization, either people on board the vessels or shore personnel, they don't actually understand the impact of both vetting and post-trade controls in the interrupted operations of the vessels. And even during the inspections, they don't pay the attention which is required to make them successful. Another challenge, to speak for another stakeholder, the industry, actually the oil majors, I think that there is lack of harmonization there. And for For example, the second example is that different majors, they have different requirements in regard to the crew experience matrix. This creates complications. And another topic is perhaps mostly related with post-state control, but only is that we face communication challenges. Sometimes language is a barrier, local culture and ethics in some cases create some issues, and perhaps even a typo in a crew certification could become a big issue, either intentionally or unintentionally. So, as an operator, certainly we should take some actions to address such kind of challenges. And I think, for example, in our case in GasLog, to address the first topic, I mean, what is going on internally with the organization, we have actually a very focused campaign and some other actions in order to address various elements of vetting. For example, we have campaigns to raise awareness of the importance, both ashore and on board. We have allocated clear accountabilities about who is responsible for what on board the vessel and ashore. We have adopted a risk-based approach, and we have actually categorized the questions, each individual question from the IQ. We monitor the performance on a vessel basis, team basis, and even on individual basis for senior officers, masters, chief engineers. We reward the good performance. And also recently we have decided that we engage with preventing consultants, although we are very careful in this regard because we do not like to pass the wrong message to the crew that we allocate responsibilities to a third party. I think on the second challenge I mentioned, we participate in industry initiatives like the one is ongoing within Intertanko, actually to move from in regard to the crew experience matrix to move from more qualitative approach and let's say somehow replace the crew experience matrix with the competency criteria. And also we work already, we keep in touch with the industry bodies, and I think we need to do more work systematically in this regard and to bring to their attention issues that we face during various post-state controls. I think that all of us would agree that vetting and post-state is a learning opportunity for each organization, the whole cycle. I mean, even the inspection on board, then the observations, how you manage, how you investigate for the causes, and how you define meaningful corrective actions is an opportunity for every organization to learn, to improve the safety systems, even the plan maintenance schemes in some cases. Having said that, though, I think that all of us also would agree that both vetting and post-state are mostly are lagging indicators and actually are in a way reactive, and I think they do not address the safety performance in a proactive way. Therefore, I think that when it comes to speak for safety culture and to link with the safety culture and performance, the operators should take the lead in introducing the organizations schemes that in order to cultivate more proactive thinking and approach. And I think this kind of initiatives definitely should address and mostly the human element, leadership, attitudes and behaviors, cooperation, collaboration, and engagement and intervention. And I think later on.
Funny, you almost covered the entire subject. But Stelios, give me a minute because I want to go to Dimitri first to continue on the shipping company's replies, and then I come to you because now you have heard Dimitri.
Good evening to all of you. Thank you for the invitation.
Panos is always provocative, focused on the hardware part of our operations. Regarding the question you said in the beginning, what are the advantages and disadvantages of these regulations? We must first think why we have the regulations. Regulations didn't come without any cause. All these regulations happened because some incidents or some accidents we had. And the purpose of all these regulations is to improve our operations. We manage tankers, mainly tankers. We have bulk carriers, but our operations are mainly focused on the tankers. And the way we're thinking is like we manage the bulkers like tankers. And we are used now to in a world to live in a world where the regulations are everyday job. And I will tell you an example of what an experience that I had early in the summer. I had to pay a leadership visit in one of our tankers discharging in Rotterdam. I took the early flight early in the morning. I arrived in Rotterdam 10 a.m. And I went on board the vessel. I first gave my, I signed my name, and I gave the card as a permission to enter the vessel from the AB who was in charge on the deck. And then I went on board the vessel, and they told me that at the same time, it was all the cargo lines of the terminal were connected to the manifolds. The vessel was ready to start the discharging operations. We had the side inspector. The side inspector was on board the vessel for side inspection. At the same time, this side inspector, there was an auditor for the side inspector who was observing the side inspector how was doing the inspection. And after half an hour, the post-state control came on board. Also, the loading master was on board, and the master and all the officers were running and were focused on how to answer and reply to all the questions, all the requirements. When I arrived on board, I said, okay, I had many years to attend such an operation, and I said I will stand by and I will observe. I was astonished how much professional our officers should be in order to, and how resilient they should be in order to overcome all these demands from these regulatory requirements and from the third-party inspections. And I realized that in order to comply with all these regulations, that we should understand that this is the life and we must comply with all these things, otherwise we don't have the ticket to trade. We must have very professional people on board. And we must have very well organized management system on shore in order to prepare our operations and prepare our people to overcome all these challenges that are coming from our industry. These are my first comments. And I must reply whether we have advantages. Personally, I see that all these regulations, despite the fact that they create a lot of problems in our management system, they are good because they improve our operations and they improve the way we operate. And the aim to have zero incident industry is something that everybody should aim to. Is it something good? For me, I understand there are problems in the implementation, but they are going to the right direction.
Indeed, I will agree with that because in reality, the base of a regulation is a reactive type of approach. It's not a proactive. And that's why this, in a way, this should be the minimum set, those regulations that the vessel has to operate. You might have heard in industry forums the substandard vessel and the substandard operator and the non-level playing field and all of that. Even today, where shipping is so transparent, highly visible, and gets from time to time a lot of criticism, still there are substandard vessels. in our oceans. Anyway, now I want Stelios Siafakas to give us his experience from previous being part of shipping companies and also now that he sees things from a consulting perspective.
Thank you, Michalis. I'm Stelios Siafakas. I'll just take the phrase that Dimitris said before, that we manage bulk carriers as tankers. I'll take also what Stavros said before, that everybody has the same target, as the safety of operations. Then why we have different criteria for bulk carriers and tankers? Why we have different management on bulk carriers and tankers on various companies? The target is the same. The approach is different. I'm sure for that the approach is different, but the target is the same. Everybody knows that the exposure of a ship owner or a ship management company maybe is the largest exposure compared to any other industry. But we have the stakeholders, we have IMO, we have oil majors, port authorities, port state control, flag state, inspections, and the large problem of the industry is that we have so many stakeholders that they are not sitting on the same table to understand each other, including ship owners, to understand each other and set up a new inspection, regulatory, or compliance regime in the industry. So my main concern for the future would be if we are going to see a combined action for all requirements, environmental, quality, safety, whatever is going to be, vetting, one entity to control the compliance, common requirements around the globe, unified inspection compliance scheme, and I believe we are talking for an utopia, or maybe this is something that can be done. We have to see in the next 10 or 20 years. I hope that we can succeed something like that and take some examples from aviation industry, for example.
Thank you, Stelios. Just to complete on the regulatory part, as we said, Port State Control are the auditors of all of these regulations. About a couple of weeks ago, I was in Cyprus Maritime, and Mr. Kim from IMO was there, and they were discussing about measure to ensure that the Port State Control in different regions, they will be level playing field, that they will try to have a uniform type of approach, not to differentiate and all of that. Something that, from a flag perspective, we receive a lot of complaints from ship managers when the vessels are being inspected by Port State Control all over the world. And with that remark, I would like to know your experience from Port State Controls for your fleets. Start from Dimitri now.
Regarding the post state controls, I consider them the criminal records of our ships. And if the criminal record is why, then we have a very positive image in trading our vessels. The post-state controls, the problem is that there is not a uniform approach on the post-state controls in different areas of the world. And we must have our vessels and our people very well prepared when they are going in different ports and the post-state control inspectors they go on board. And we must not facilitate their different approaches regarding the inspections. I don't want to speak in detail in front of an audience regarding the different approaches of the post-state controls, but we have examples that the post-state controls, even in tankers, it's not level playing field all over the world.
I agree with Dimitris and what he has mentioned already. Also in our operations, in our company, we face challenges. Definitely different areas in the world have different cultures and different standards. And linked with what I have said before, this creates also, introduce a risk in our operations because, you know, some of the crew are, let's say, relaxed when they face lower standards in one area of the world, and then they go in another with completely different standards, and they do not change the approach, and all of a sudden we have issues. I think that definitely this is something that we should collectively address.
Something, okay, and we know about those areas, in order to hold the ship and do some kind of extortion, not to the company, but to the captain. They say to the captain, well, we found this, you know, and now, you know, we're going to report it to the company, we're going to detain the ship and this and that, and the captain starts pleading with them to let him go. That's something, this has been going on for more than 10 years now. Something has to be done about those specific areas. And I'm afraid there are other areas are also getting this example of money making and they're getting into the game and something has to be done. I don't know if it's going to be at IMO level or whatever. With regard to third party inspections, Stelios had a very good point. Should there be different standards for bulk carriers and tankers? I say, of course, yes, there should be different standards. The consequences of a damage or an accident from a tanker in bulk carrier are not the same. So yes, there should be different standards, and I don't like that some organizations are trying to impose TMSA-style, mandatory inspection regime for bulk carriers. It's a new thing now. And they are trying to pass it on, and I don't think we need it. And after all, TMSA, OKIMF, majors, they know about ships, okay? They have every right to do inspections, and they do proper inspections. In bulk areas, we don't have majors and OKIMF. We have some companies that they named themselves to be bulk carrier experts, and they're actually accountants and lawyers, trying to rate the ships in different ratings. They give you intentionally I'll mention it. I don't have a problem. RightShip used to have two different indexes for ships. They used to have the environmental index for ships, which I always say it's garbage. And also the charterers know it doesn't mean anything. And that's why most of the charterers, except for the owners of RightShip, don't ask for a good environmental rating. But the RightShip had the safety system, which was how many stars the ship had, which had some basis. That was a good proper system because it was based on what kind of flag are you, what kind of classification is the ship, is it an Ajax class, did you have any detentions and deficiencies recently in the ports and all that, so it had some basis in fact. Recently, they changed their algorithm, they reduced all the stars of all the ships to two or three stars, even new ships, a few months old, no deficiencies, whatever, Ajax class, Quality Ship 21 USA flag, the ship gets two stars. Obviously, there is a tendency from these organizations to lower the safety record of the ship so they can sell you vetting later, okay, let us go in and vet the ship in order to increase the star rating. Now, those things have no place. I mean, we have enough problems. We shouldn't have those artificial problems to think about.
Stelio, would you like to add something?
Actually, I don't want to open any argument with Panos regarding that. I still believe that the safety of operations is the main target. Both bulk carriers and tankers should have any kind of ship, not only bulk carriers or tankers or whatever, must have the same target of safety of operations, the same standards, but different approach, as I said before. The approach, of course, the procedures are different. We have other issues, we have other risks on tankers, other risks on bulk carriers or cruise vessels. But how we are going to get to reach the point of safety of operations, I think everybody understands that is somebody. Everything we should strive to the same target. On the other hand, I would like to add something on the port state control. Just imagine that the flag administration or the class societies would be responsible for, let's say, instead of the port state control, perform the safety audits for the port calls. What would happen if we manage to do that in the future, let's say? The risk and the responsibility goes to the class or to the flag administration. The port state control is not there, and every time something happens, the port state control would go to the RO.
You know, this, what you mentioned now, I remember some lord in Great Britain. A few years back, he have said, in an ideal world, if all ships are safe and blah, 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 no port state control will be required, as the flag state will be responsible for the whole thing. I mean, this is an old story that I remember one good Greek ship owner about 30, 40 years ago that he was questioning in every meeting we had, why do we need class societies? Maybe some of you might relate the name, but it was one of his very interesting derogatives that only flag states you need and the IMO and nobody else. But anyway, but one thing that among these replies of yours, the human factor, the human factor on board, no matter if it is on a bulk carrier, a tanker, on an LNG or an LPG or in an offshore mobile platform, is very important. And it's critical, I would say. And earlier in the morning, you heard that dedication, training, dedicated training, and I guess I have read some navigational issues that they are discussing at IMO and all of that. Dedicated training per position, per job assignment, per task assignment on board and all that. How is the human factor affects application of the regulation on board the vessel? I mean, a lot of times the crew may not be as responsible, or is the crew behaves similarly if a port state control inspector is on board or if an oil major vetting inspector is on board? I have heard and seen differences. Can you comment on things like that? I mean, Dimitri.
The human factor is the most important factor for the implementation of what you plan in your management system. You may have the best systems, the best management systems, but you rely on the people on board. That's what I realized in the summer, that you must have very professional, very well trained, very well educated officers on board, especially for the tankers. Because, and I will agree with Panos, the tankers are different from the bulk carriers. Completely different, because the consequences are different, the charters are different. Also, the charters, because they had some bad experiences in the past, they are trying to avoid all this bad experience they had. And they try to make, to improve the way we operate on board our vessels. And in our hands and in our responsibility is to have the best people, to try to find and hire the best people from the early years in the company, and then invest on these officers and develop them in order to understand how to operate in the world, in the industry we operate today, and not the way we operated in the past. We live in a very transparent environment. Everything is, we cannot hide anything, and therefore we need a different approach. And the people should understand and make them understand with the training how to operate on board of vessels.
I want to ask you a single line. If you want to offer a recommendation to improve safety for the shipping industry in general, can you offer one line?
We must create safety culture, and this safety culture should have an holistic approach, and everybody should have a commitment to the safety. It's not only the persons on board, also the people ashore, because we have experiences where the safety is some people who have worked in the 60s, the 80s or the 90s, they have a different approach. For example, we have one equipment failure. And you ask them why this equipment failed. And they say this is an equipment, we are talking about ships and there are problems. But if you dig in and you take a human behavior approach to this and you see that there are issues, how this equipment failed. And you will see that the human factor played an important role in this one. And the safety culture, it's something that is a journey in our industry. And also regarding the experience we have each other, it's very important to exchange them in order to make our knowledge better and educate more our people on board.
Thank you for the one line. Funny, would you like?
It's not an easy issue. If we knew the recipe in one line.
What would remain with the audience, so that.
Yes, so I would like first to pick up the comment about the difference between bulk carriers and tankers, and also to state my views. I think that, that of course cargo operations obviously are different, which is a major part, a big part of the operations. However, there are other elements like the navigation, for example, which actually there's no difference between any kind of vessel. And so I think it's not, it's maybe simplified to say that are different or not different. And of course, if we take into account what has been said by more or less all of us, that the human element is perhaps the most critical in the business, I think definitely there is no difference between bulk carriers or tankers or any other type of vessels, even LNG, that we operate. I think that as operators we face two challenges. To the level that we are discussing now about post-state control and vetting, I think there is very big space, and we should make the industry, the other stakeholders by the industry, to understand that there is space to consolidate, to adopt a more unified approach. What Dimitri said in the beginning, his example, I mean, when the vessel sails for 1 month and has to spend 1 day in the port, and there are 2, 3, 4 such kind of activities, this perhaps is introduce a hazard to the operation, despite the fact that actually is oriented, the objective is to contribute to more safe operations. At the end, at the day that the vessel is in port, is more hazardous, perhaps. And the second challenge for the operators is exactly to work with the human element and to take it to the next level, to address attitudes and behaviors. Ultimately, no matter the type of the vessel, is the human element, the human behavior that will prevent, is the last line of defense in order to prevent incidents and accidents and ensure safe operations.
Thank you, Stavros.
Yes, I will try to keep it two lines as you ask. I will try at least. One? Okay.
Human and then one line.
Okay. Yeah, human and one line. From my point of view, there's two words, two main cornerstones, if you want, for the safety, regarding the safety. Commitment. Commitment, as Dimitris mentioned earlier, it's very, very important. First of all, it's coming from the office. This is my point of view. Starting from the office, and then we have to get this on board the vessel, the commitment from our people on board. And the second is to be proactive. If we are proactive, we can prevent a lot of things with regards to safety. This is my point of view. This is my approach. This is what we are trying, at least in our company, to do, to be committed and to be proactive.
I agree with that, and it has been mentioned in the previous panels too. It's two main things, training and culture, safety culture. And the safety culture, of course, starts from the office. And when the crews really see that you mean it, then that culture drips down to the ship. And training, of course, will make them actually do the job as the culture that you set actually requires. Thanks.
Thank you, and before we conclude, yes, Stelio, sorry.
Just one phrase.
Yes.
As an old guy said, excellence is not an act but a habit, either if it's a fishing boat, tanker, or a bulk carrier.
Well thought. On an airplane, right? Before I conclude this, I want to, first of all, thank all of you and thank the panelists. I want to offer my one-liner, of me having worked in Greece and in the United States in shipping industries. We need to work together more, regulatory bodies like the IMO, but also other bodies, Intertanko, Intercargo, International Shipping Council, shipping companies. It's interesting that one of the people that was participating in the Geneva Convention on MLC, where it was a tripartite agreement, like ship owners, flag administration, seamen union, and Liberia was part, and I asked him from the ship owners who came, and he told me some tugboat operators, fishing vessel operators and stuff like that, and they were not major ship owning bodies, etc. So I think we need to work more together, because at the end of the day the aim is one and only, a better life for the world at large, and shipping, due to the importance in transporting goods from one place to the other, goods that we use also in this room, it's very important, so we do need to work together. Thank you very much, Nicholas, and all of you.